welcome to the channel. Today we'll walk through a couple of papers by Miklov and his team at Google that introduced Word2Vec back in 2013. Since then, Word2Vec has arguably become one of the most popular word embedding models, and word embedding has become a de facto standard to replace feature engineering in almost all natural language processing tasks. In this video, we'll walk through some of the important sections of the paper. I'll try supplementing the text with more explanation and illustrative examples, which will hopefully help drive the understanding of the intuition behind some of the main ideas in the papers. So massive thank you for anyone who's watching this. Let's jump right into it. The first paper we are going to look at is efficient estimation of word representations in vector space. Word representations in vector space means exactly what it says, representing words as vectors. Let's take an example to get comfortable with the idea of using vectors to represent things. Imagine three students, John, Sam, and Nick, studying three subjects A, B, and C, and let's represent each student as a vector of their marks that they get in these subjects. So let's say John gets a 6 in subject A, 5 in B, 9 in C, Sam gets a 1, 2, and 1, Nick gets a 6, 4, and 8. What we have done here is represented each student as a vector of their marks in three subjects. Now, if we remove these subjects and just look at those word embedding, what we can say is John is very similar to Nick in whatever these word embeddings encode. Similarly, in this paper, we want to learn embeddings for words that encode the idea of syntactic and semantic word similarity. Syntactic similarities means like similarity between embeddings for word big and bigger because they are syntactically similar. And semantic similarities means having embeddings that can capture the notion of analogies like man is to king is same as woman is too. And we can use these embeddings for man, king, and woman to get to the embedding of queen. So the idea to represent words as vectors was not something new that this paper introduced. Previously, people worked on language models, such as the task of predicting the next word in a sentence. For such a task, as we will see in the next section, the word embeddings were produced, but as a byproduct. The main difference that the Word2Vec model introduced in this paper was that its explicit goal was to generate word embeddings, and that helped the authors in improving the computational complexity to generate good word embeddings. The author introduced two novel model architectures. The first one is called SkipGram, where they look at the representations of the input word to predict the surrounding words. And the second one is called Continuous Bag of Words model, where they look at the representations of the surrounding words to predict the center word. Now, let's go ahead and look into the details of these two models. The next section we look at is feedforward neural network language model. This is basically the description of the classical neural language model, which was proposed by Bengio back in 2003. The task of this model was to predict the next word in a sequence. For example, if you feed a model the sequence of these words and then ask it to predict the next word. The structure of the model was encoding each of these words as one hot encoded vector. In this particular example, the word duh, input, layer, and then project these one hot encoded vector into a projection layer of dimension n into d. Then have a hidden layer of dimension h, and then an output layer of dimension v. V here is the size of the vocabulary, and n in our example is 4. Since we are looking at 4 previous words to predict the fifth word, the computational complexity of this model for each training example is given by n into d, which is the cost to create the projection, n into d into h, which is the cost to go from the projection to the hidden layer, and h into v, which is the cost to calculate the final output layer. As we know, the size of the vocabulary is going to be huge for any language, and as such, this is usually the dominating term. The authors for this say that they can reduce the complexity of the softmax function by using a hierarchical version of it. The vanilla softmax is defined as, so what the softmax function does is it amplifies the bigger value while retaining the smaller values at some minimum level. This part is why it's called soft, and this part is why it's called the max. The denominator here is what is responsible for this calculation being computationally expensive because it normalizes over the whole size of the vocabulary. But we can reduce this complexity to log v by using hierarchical binary tree softmax. In that case, the most complexity comes from the middle term. But what the authors say next is that they're going to remove the hidden layer from their proposed architectures, and therefore the h into v term would again come back to having the maximum complexity, and therefore such optimizations by using, let's say, hierarchical softmax are going to be important. By the way, if you're new to neural net or hierarchical softmax, I'll put in links to tutorials in the description below. But what we will see in the next sections is that the Word2Vec implementation, at least the one that is widely used, uses neither of these two. Let's look into that now. In the first paper, the one that we're discussing right now, the authors have proposed these two architectures for learning word embeddings that are computationally less expensive than the previous models, and they also generate much more accurate word embeddings. But in the second paper, which we will look at in a few minutes, they actually improve upon these models by employing additional strategies to enhance the training speed and accuracy. The architecture suggested by the authors offer two main benefits over the feedforward neural net language model that we just discussed. The first one is that they do away with the expensive hidden layer, and the second one is that they enable the language model to take additional context into account. The way they do this is they break down the one-step problem of predicting the next word into a two-step problem. Let's take an example to understand what that means. The feedforward neural net language model used to look at the previous n words for predicting the next word. By breaking down the task of predicting the next word into two steps, where the first step was just generating the word embeddings, they actually allowed the model to use context for the words that follow the word that learned the word embedding for. This additional context helped the model to come up with more accurate word embeddings. Once we have those accurate word embeddings, we can then train another neural net language model to actually do the task of predicting the next word. We first look at the continuous bag of words model. As we discussed, while a language model is only able to look at the past words for its predictions, as it is evaluated on its ability to predict each next word in the corpus, a model that just aims to generate accurate word embeddings does not suffer from this restriction. So what the authors did with the continuous bag of word models was to use the n words before and after the target word to predict it. They call this continuous bag of words as it uses continuous representations whose order is of no importance. Also note that the model does away with the hidden layer. So the complexity is in the projection layer and the final output layer. The second architecture that they suggest is called the continuous SIPGRAM model. In this architecture, instead of using the surrounding words to predict the center word, they actually use the center word to predict the surrounding words. The cost of this model is given by the projection layer and the output layer. And since we have C of the context words, the cost is multiplied C times for each log linear classifier. In the author's second paper, they actually deep dive into the SKIPGRAM model. If you look at the cost that the authors indicate for the softmax function, it indicates that they are using a hierarchical softmax function to approximate the expensive softmax. But in the next paper, the authors discuss ways to approximate the expensive softmax as well as the key training decisions that account for much of SKIPGRAM's success. So let's look into the second paper to understand the SKIPGRAM model in more details. In the second paper, the authors try to address some of the complexities for training the SKIPGRAM model that they suggested in their first paper. Before looking into that, let's walk through a quick example to make sure we understand where the computational complexity for the SKIPGRAM model is coming from. SKIPGRAM model takes the center word and tries to predict the probability of the surrounding words. The input layer would be a one-hot encoded vector of size v, where v is the size of the vocabulary, and we have 1 for the index of our input word and zeros for all the remaining words. The projection layer or the hidden layer would be of size n, and the output layer would again be of size v, where each index would represent the probability of that word occurring in the neighborhood of the input word. Let's call these matrix of weights from each input neuron to each hidden layer neuron a word embedding matrix, and from the hidden neuron to the output layer as the word embedding matrix for the context words. As you may recall, the computational complexity comes from the output layer, where we apply the softmax function to get the individual probabilities for each of the word in the vocabulary lying in the neighborhood of the input word. The authors address these issues in this paper with two innovations. First is modifying the optimization objective with a technique they call negative sampling, which causes each training sample to update only a small percentage of weights in this word embedding matrix for context words. And the second optimization they do is subsampling the frequent words like and off, etc., to decrease the number of training examples. It is worth noting that subsampling frequent words and applying negative sampling not only reduce the compute burden of the training process, but it actually improved the quality of the resulting word embeddings as well. Before we jump further into the details of these two optimization techniques, one quick thing to note here is that the hidden layer in the SKIPGRAM architecture has no nonlinear activations. So what it essentially ends up doing is selecting a row in the word embedding matrix for the input word. First, let's take a closer look into the objective function for the script graph model. So what we want to do is maximize the probability of the occurrence of the surrounding word given the word embeddings for the center word. And we want to maximize this probability across all the neighboring words, both C left and C to the right of the center word. And we want to maximize this probability over all the words in our training corpus. We then take a log to change it into a summation and we average it across all the words in the training corpus. The way we calculate this probability is using the softmax function. But before we look into that, let's quickly discuss the two matrices that we discussed earlier. First is the word embedding matrix for the input word, and the second is the word embedding matrix for the output word. Note that each word in the vocabulary will have a representation in the input matrix as well as in the output matrix. These word embeddings are denoted by VW and VW dash. So then the probability of a context word occurring in the neighborhood of an input word is given by this softmax, where we take the output representation for the context word and multiply it with the input representation for the input word. And as we discussed, we need to divide this with a summation over all words in the vocabulary so that the probabilities sum up to 1, which is what makes the softmax expensive. Now let's look at how we fix this. In the vanilla skipgram model, the fake task was that given an input word, what was the probability of a word in the vocabulary occurring in the neighborhood of the input word? Note that I call the task fake since at the end of the day, we are just interested in learning these word embeddings and we are going to throw away the network. With negative sampling, what the authors suggest is to change the task from predicting the neighboring word to answering the question if the two words are neighbors. Now, what this allows us to do is change the task from a multinomial classification problem to a binary classification problem, where we can now replace the softmax function with the less expensive sigmoid function. This approach is called negative sampling because for a binary classifier, we would also need to sample negative samples, that is word pairs that do not occur in the neighborhood in the training corpus as negative samples with the zero label, so that a classifier is able to classify both zero for not neighbors and one for neighbors given two input words. Now, if you look at the objective function, instead of plugging in a softmax, we plug in a sigmoid function for the positive samples and another sigmoid for the k negative samples. These k negative examples are sampled from a noise distribution, which is essentially the normalized monogram distribution raised to the power of alpha, where alpha is a hyperparameter which the authors say yields the best result at the value 3/4 and has the effect of smoothing the unigram distribution. The second optimization that the authors do is subsampling frequent words like in, da, and a. They use the following formulation, where PWI is the probability of discarding word WI, FWI is the frequency of that word in the corpus, and T is a hyperparameter. So as you can see, higher the frequency of the word in the corpus, higher is the probability of it getting discarded. I hope with this quick walkthrough through some of the important sections of the Word2Vec papers, you get a good idea of what is Word2Vec and what do we mean by skipgram with negative sampling. The authors have several results here which you can look at. One of the important results was the authors looking at word analogies. So for example, what this shows is that if you take word embeddings for king, subtract the word embedding for man, and add the word embedding for woman, you get the word embedding for the word queen. This really captured the imagination of the readers and goes to show that we can achieve meaningful word embeddings with minimal computational complexity. The code for this is open source, so you can have a look to understand how it was implemented by the authors. I will link this and a few of really good blogs on Word2Vec in the description below. Thanks for your time.